Good morning, it's Wednesday morning. I greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Selamat sore to my Indonesian friends. I hear South Africa is really, really cold. But here in Indonesia, it's hot, it's paradise. I welcome you this morning. Regarding the word this morning, regarding what I would like to share with you. Because we know that the word, but not just the word, but also what we hear from God. And we all need to rise in faith. We need to believe. One of the biggest time after time said to his disciples, "Be of little faith." We are confronted with storms in our life. The question is, do you have enough faith to tell the storm to calm down? Do you have the faith when something, you know, when there's lacking, to what you have, to just bring before God and thank Him, but knowing God can multiply? So what I'm saying is this morning, I want to encourage you. You know, we're looking for answers all over, but at the end, it's all in the Word of God. And your spirit just need to connect with the Word and it will bring a revelation. So yes, but yeah, good morning. So I'm happy, I'm excited to be with you this morning. Forgive me for Monday, I just had some unforeseen issues that happened and I was not in time. But today's message, I want to talk about temptation. You know, and if I can give this message a name, I want to tell you, run from temptation. You know, it's so easy that we allow sin in our lives. It's so easy. But the question is, where does it come from? Is this a new thing in your life, or is it just something random that happened? Why do we struggle? Hello, Rajan, my friend. I'm so glad you tuned in this morning. But let's get to the Word of God. I want to start this morning in the beginning. In Genesis chapter 3, we read the following. We read, "Now the serpent was more crafty." I want to just pause for a moment. The serpent is not lazy. The serpent is not, the devil is not, he's cunning. And we read here that he was more crafty than any beast of the field. He's clever, which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Indeed, has God said?" He comes and he quoted something God has said. "You shall not eat from any tree of the garden." Is it so that you cannot do this? Because many times the reason in your mind, the enemy, the devil, is using our senses to capture our flesh. And I don't want to run myself to the front. But the fact is, we are confronted every day in so many areas. We are being tempted by the devil. And you know what? I want to help you today. And if you fall into sin by temptation, I would really like to give you something so you can get out. Amen. So we see that the devil comes to Eve and he said, "You shall not," has God not said, "You shall not eat from any tree of the garden?" He asked the question. And the woman said to the serpent, "From the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat." Answer correctly. "But from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat from it or touch it, lest you die." So the devil is so cunning, he will tell you what you already know. The first problem here is, she should have never interacted with the enemy. You see, the first thing we do when temptation comes, we start to reason. Our mind is working, calculating the cost, calculating. But the moment we get into this mind communication with ourselves regarding what God has said, we already allow the enemy into us, into our lives. And then he said, in verse, in Genesis chapter 3 verse 4. So now he answers her, and she answered correctly. And he said, the serpent said to her, "Woman, you surely shall not die. Now, I want to stop there. Because sin is this thing that we experience. And the thing is, our mind and reason and natural human flesh said, you shall not die. But sin, the problem is, brings separation between you and God. That's sin. Sin is basically when you allow that. Temptation is only the first step that will bring you to the place where you will actually sin. And this is what happened. So there was first a communication between the woman Eve and the serpent. And he quoted. But the fact is, the moment she got into this conversation, he said to her, you know what, you will not die. Today we have a big problem, Alone Alpha. We have a big, big problem in the church because we allow sin so easily. It's like we say, well, Jesus died on the cross, we just repent. So we misuse grace, God's grace, as an excuse to sin. But my focus today is not sin, but it's what's leading to sin. And I'm talking about temptation this morning. Now I want to read to you in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 10, verse 13. Now I'm telling you, when there's, you are tempted, my friend, you know, just get your tackies on and run. Amen. So 1 Corinthians chapter 10 in the Amplified Translation says the following. For no temptation, and then it explains, no trial regarded as enticing to sin, no matter how it comes or where it leads, has overtaken you and lay hold on you. That is not common to man. So what is it? You know what? What happened in the beginning with Adam and Eve is still happening. This is not new. The same plan, the same strategy. The devil is still the liar. He is still the one that wants to deceive you. He is still the one that wants to capture you and bring separation between you and God. You remember when Adam and Eve sinned, what happened? They hide. Isn't it so that the moment we allow sin in our lives, doesn't matter how small, it's like we struggle, hello Elizabeth, we struggle to get into that presence of God. It's like we're hiding. Because this is what sin does. But temptation is the vehicle the enemy is using. So he said, for no temptation has overtaken you and lay hold of you. That is not common to man. That is, no temptation or trial has come to you that is beyond human resistance. So there's a promise here. It means we cannot say, well, I'm tempted, sorry, I'm just a poor soul, I allow it. No, it says that in the Word of God that it's not beyond human resistance. You can resist it. Don't allow the lie. Don't allow the devil to work on the areas of your life where you are weak, because that's the areas he will attack. So you cannot say, well, sorry, I cannot. No. But also this morning, I want to tell you how to deal with this. So he says, it's not beyond human resistance, and that is not adjusted and adapted and belonging to human experience, and such as man can bear. But God is faithful to his word and his compassionate nature, and he can be trusted not to let you be tempted and tried and assayed beyond your ability and strength of resistance and power to endure. But with the temptation, he, God, will always provide the way out. You know, God loves us so much, even he knows he will give us a way out. Maybe today you are enticed in temptation and sin. Maybe you feel, I'm so bound. Maybe it can be alcohol abuse. It can be sexual abuse. It can, or sexual related. It can be pornographic. It can be so many things that bring separation between you and God. Hello, Moses. Good morning. So bring separation between you and God. But I want to tell you something. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, that whatever you tempted and tried and said, will not be beyond your ability or strength of resistance and power to it. But with the temptation, God will always provide a way out. Now, the Amplified tell us the means of escape to a landing place, that you may be capable and strong and powerful to bear up, under it patiently. So God is so in control, even when we are not. The main thing is, my friend, today, don't allow temptation. Don't allow the enemy. Even God will help you. You understand? But you must understand, we cannot just sin and repent sin. It's not like that, because your nature, the Spirit of God in you, will don't want you to sin. Because the moment you sin, you are separated. You feel like Adam and Eve in hiding. Amen. I said everyone has to deal with temptation at one time or another. So you don't feel need to feel embarrassed. You're the only one. There's so many people in church today, so many people that's not even sinners, but God's people, that are entangled in temptations and sin in their life. And many people are facing that right now. But at the same time, you don't have to succumb to temptation. You don't have to. Don't do that. Because it is something you can overcome. Jesus already got through the word. He said he will provide a way out. I mean, all temptations, I want you to hear, all temptations can be beaten. You just have to make up your mind that you're going to be the conqueror and not to be conquered. You must understand, when Jesus died, he gave you the victory. Revelation 12:11 said, we have the victory through the blood of Jesus and our witnessing or our confession. So we have victory. Amen. But I want to go to Galatians. So the one thing we talk about is temptation. Now the question, how does it work? You know, it's not just random. Usually the enemy is using the part in your flesh that is weak. He knows the weak spot. He knows the weak link. So in Galatians chapter 5:16, it describes how this happened. We have the five senses, and these senses will influence what we see, feel, touch, and hear, smell, and taste. It will influence the flesh, the body. The moment you receive that, it comes to the main brain, and then you start to reason regarding this. And then you have the moral, let's call it the morality, what the Word of God through His Spirit give you, that tells you, no, this is wrong. And then you have the flesh that tell you, ah, it's not so bad. So we have constant something happen. Now Galatians 5:16 speaks about this, verse 16 and 17. But I say, walk and live habitually, meaning constantly in the Holy Spirit. What does it mean? Being constant, responsive to and controlled and guided by the Spirit. Constant. You must be guided by the Spirit, not by what you see, you feel. Maybe you've lost your job, and there comes an opportunity to maybe to deal in stolen cell phones. But you're a child of God. But in your reason, I need money. I need to live. This is not so bad. So the enemy will tell you, God will not supply your needs. Here is an opportunity. Or maybe even in your job, compromises, maybe a bribe. You must understand, the enemy wants to bind and control you the moment. He will bring the temptation. Amen. And in the weak area of your life. But I say, walk and live habitually in the Holy Spirit, responsive to and control and be guided by the Spirit. Then he says, then you will certainly not. I mean, if you walk by the Spirit, God will give you the authority. God will give you the mandate. Doesn't matter what's happening, because the moment you walk in the Spirit, you know, you don't live what you reason, but you live what you believe. Amen. Through your heart. And he said, you will certainly not gratify the cravings and desires of the flesh. The human nature without God. So, you see, that's the area the devil attacks. That's the areas you not yet allow God for his light to come in. That's the areas in your life, it's like you keep it, you know, just that back door. Maybe, maybe not. You know, my wife is not really nice to me, but you know, the secretary is okay. You see, the enemy will always bring something that will attract you. But the Spirit of God is the one that said no. You understand? So your reaction out of what you're going to do started with the temptation. Now verse 17 says the following. For the desires of the flesh are opposed to the Holy Spirit. So whatever desires is out of the flesh is the opposite of the Holy Spirit. And the desires of the Spirit are opposed to the flesh, the godless human nature. For these are antagonistic to each other, continually withstanding and conflict with each other. So, my friend, you have constant a battle every day. You know, even when you put on your phone and there's all of these things going to pornographic sites, these things that will draw you to lustful things, the things. So there's constant this battle that's going on, the conflict between the flesh and the spirit. So we must understand what Galatians 5, 16 and 17 said. You have a spirit door and you have a flesh door. If you open this, if you walk in the spirit door open, and all the things you will do that will influence you by the Spirit through the Word of God will go through, and you will live within the Spirit, and you will say no to sin, and you will say no to the things that is not in line with God. But you cannot open both doors. So how the devil tempt you as a Christian, if the spirit door is open, he must catch you through your senses by something, and then you start to reason, and the moment you start to think on things, it started to influence your control in the spirit, and then you start to open the door of the flesh. And if you open the door of the flesh, the spirit door is closed, because you step in, you move in to open the door of the flesh. And if you don't run for it, if you don't deal with it, the flesh door will start, the desires and the cravings of the flesh will start influence your spirit. Amen. Because it says, so that you are not free but are prevented from doing what you desire to do. So we cannot just do whatever we want. You either walk in the spirit and the door is open. That's why the word said, fill you with the word. Fill yourself with worship. Fill yourself with the things of God. Then the spirit, you will walk habitually in the spirit. But if not, if you stand with two legs, one in the world, one in a spiritual, let's say in the word of God, you are actually deceived. James chapter 1 verse 8 said, a double-minded man is unstable on his ways. What happens? Because you allow the world to influence you, just like the devil came to Eve and said, is it not, you know, that you cannot eat that? You know what God said? What God said is a lie. And that's where the moment we start to reason, we open the flesh door. And the moment we start, sin is not just you wake up one morning and I'm going to sin. No, sin starts with the five senses and the reasoning, and then this battle, and then it's the selfishness of the flesh and the self-righteousness that makes you come into line. And then, because you must understand, the devil will start hitting on that tree, cutting. At some point, if you don't deal with that, that door will open, that tree will fall. And if the moment it falls, you will step into sin, and it will influence your life and relationship and the people around you. Maybe you've not thought about it before, but the devil tries to lure you into sin by using your mind and emotions. He injects thoughts into your mind and emotions that act as a stimulus to get you all stirred up in a certain area of your life. What happened? The moment you allow to think on things of the flesh, the devil is already halfway in your house. He's already busy, because the moment you start to think on these things, it will attract and it will affect your emotions. At that moment you are consciously aware that you can let the temptation pass you by. Because you know there's a point where you can say, I don't want, and you move on. If you on your phone and there's a pornographic site or something that triggered you, you have a choice. There's a point where you can say no, but the moment you think of, so what does the devil do? He will bring you the things you don't have, or the things you lust after, or the things you're craving after. So, in short, basically, I will come there. When your soul is out of peace, the enemy will come in more easy. But I will talk about that right now. So there's a time that you can say, you know what, devil, I rebuke you, I stand my ground, and the Bible says he will flee from you. Amen. Or you can allow those thoughts to fester in your mind, take root on your emotions until they become a major stronghold in your mind to battle and conquer. By refusing to accept these thoughts in the first place, you can avoid the struggle. Now, coming back to Galatians 5, 16 and 17 speaks about, you know, this battle between spirit and flesh. Now the question is, how can the flesh capture the soul? Because the soul dimension is your decision making. So whatever happens in your heart, in the spirit, whatever happens in your mind, in the flesh, both is conquering, both is in a battle to capture your soul. And the moment the flesh captures, you will start to sin and you will fall for temptation. If not, you walk in the spirit, the other way around. Amen. So, but how can the flesh capture the soul? Well, conscious choice. We know what is right and wrong. Even Eve knew what was right and wrong. Still the devil, when he said to her, you will not die. What did that happen? She chose to take the fruit. Even she knew God said, do not do that. So it was a constant choice by her not to obey God. Amen. The second one, lack of knowledge. Sometimes we do not have the knowledge. You know, it sounds simple, but sometimes, you know, you find yourself in a position that you were not actually, you were not prepared for that. The third one is just plain deception. The devil just plainly deceived Eve. He will just deceive you. You know, the person that actually comes with nice things is only by deception. And the fourth one, by twisting the truth. Sometimes we reason so much to justify the works of the flesh that we're twisting the truth because we say, it's not so bad. You know what? God will forgive me. The problem is you're walking on a thin line. Because you know what is right, you know what is wrong, but still you choose to walk in the flesh and to allow temptation. And you know what? There's a consequence to that sin or to that temptation. So what is the purpose of the flesh? Well, either Jesus in you, in your spirit will walk, or you will walk in, or you in the flesh will work. So, you know, the Bible tells us exactly as children of God how to live. God, there's nothing that we can say we did not know. It's all in the Word of God. And you know what God said, how we can live? What? By the Word. By in God's presence. If not, habitually live in the Holy Spirit. If not, if you start slacking and backsliding, guess what? You open more and more the flesh door and you start moving out of the grace of God, out of His protection, out of His fullness. Amen. When the soul is out of peace, the flesh will bring basically comfort. And what type of comfort will it bring? Well, it can be drugs, can be liquor, it can be addictions, it can be pornography, lusts, it can be so many sins, so many things. You know, even people with eating disorders. So when the soul is out of peace, the fridge the enemy will use to tell you, just eat something. But just now you ate a full dinner, or you ate a full lunch. 20 minutes later, it's like you're craving. You suddenly want a packet of chips or ice cream. That's not from your body, don't need that. That's because your soul is out of peace. Now the flesh comes with a comfort, a short-term solution with a long-term distraction. So what happened? You feel you need something. That's out of your emotion. It's out of the flesh. It's a temptation. Now you go to the fridge. You open up and you pour yourself a Coke with all of that sugars, and it adds to your weight. And then tonight when you shower, you look at yourself in the mirror, and then you feel, I am not worthy. But what happened? That's the consequences, because your soul is out of peace and you start having this relationship with the fridge itself. You understand? So what happens? Many people diet and have all of these things. What's the problem? Bring your soul back into peace. Take back what the enemy has stolen. You understand? So it's just what you take in. But the enemy will, and we sometimes, we in Bahasa Indonesia, we say bodoh. Bodoh means stupid, or tolol means stupid. Sometimes we like that. We want to diet, but we have all these nice things in your fridge. It's just water the fridge, you open up, and all of these things that the soul that's out of peace craving is there. Why allow that? Just stop buying Coke. Just stop buying any gas or any sodas. Just stop buying the things you crave for, because if it's not in your house, at least you will have one step, because you have a choice to get in your car and to buy that. But we just bring that to our house and we still want to diet. So what moved the soul out of peace? Well, fear. In 1 John 4:18, where the love did not become, let me just read that for you. In the book of 1 John, let's just go there. 1 John. I really love this scripture in 1 John, because the biggest problem is usually what we have or what we face. 1 John chapter 4, verse 18. It says the following: there is no fear in love. My friend, broken relationship, lack of love will bring your soul out of peace. The flesh will come with a solution, either it's drugs or alcohol or cigarette or food or whatever, or maybe just sit in front of the TV and you call it, well, I just need to unwind. But you know what? Laziness is because we justify ourselves a time of rest. A time of just, I've worked the whole day. Well, that's true. But why you want to sit and for 5 hours do nothing in front of you? Because your soul is out of peace. You're restless. And you think, just as like somebody eating by sitting in front of the TV, you will feel better. My friend, still tonight when you go to bed, you will not feel better. But the problem is there's a consequence. Because the lack of communication, relationship with your wife and children, because you sit in front of TV, will have an effect in their lives. You will bring something in their lives that they will struggle with your same justification and the truth that you basically just sort of changed. Amen. So it says in 1 John 4:18, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves punishment. And the one who fears is not perfected in love. So the bottom line is, if you're not perfected in love, guess what? It will move your soul out of peace. Hello, Tani Meti. So lekker om te sien vir jou. The second thing, what moves the soul out of peace? The fear of death. The fear of death. We try to save ourselves. It's Jesus that died on the cross. Jesus is the one that wants to help you. Amen. So what does the soul do when agitated by fear? Well, it cuts off the life of God in the spirit. So the moment your soul is out of peace, you open the flesh door, it cuts you off from God. And because the fear is the thing that cuts you, because fear is the opposite of faith. So the moment you have fear, the moment you have all of the stress and anxiety, what happened? It's punishment, because you struggle to sleep. You struggle to feel happy. You struggle to have the joy of God. Because it's the punishment that flows out of. What's the problem? Your soul is out of peace. Why is it out of peace? Because there's an area of your life that lacks the love of Christ. There's a darkness where the light needs to shine in. Amen. The second thing, what does the soul do when agitated by fear? Well, it seeks to save its own life. So what happened? You want to save your life. This is where the white lies so easy come in. Because we know many times people will have an argument and there will be the same outcome. Usually, this, especially married couples. But after 3-4 times, what will happen? Because either husband or wife know the outcome, they will either just tell a lie and say, ah, it's nothing. But what happens? The soul dimension is out of peace. And what happened is you will try to save your own life. By how? By not entering into the situation and deal with the situation. And so how do we save our own life? Well, fleshly comfort. It can be alcohol, it can be drugs, it can be sex, it can be food, it can be shopping, it can be overly television or overly sports. Sometimes women will lay in a bath for 2 hours. But you know what? After the bath, 20 minutes or 1 hour after, she still feels the same. Because the solution is not your long bath. The solution is not your television. The solution is not your food. The problem is your soul is out of peace. And now the enemy comes and he torments you because you do short-term solutions. Either you eat out of your ordinary cycles or all of these things. But there's consequences, and that's how the enemy tempts you and me. So what activates the fear? Well, we've read in 1 John 4:18, lack of love. The understanding that Jesus really loves me. It's his battle, not your battle, but you must allow him. Amen. The second thing, what activates fear? Well, lack of faith. Because faith works through love. I want you to see something. So what activates fear? It's the lack of God's love. 1 John 4:18. So if the love did not come to maturity, you understand, it produced fear. But faith works in love. Faith, love is like the electricity. Faith works through love. So if you failed in love or you feel not loved, it moves your soul out of peace. Because the substance, the electricity that's needed to put on the light, faith is the thing, is the switch. But love, a lack of love, even you put on your faith and you quote the scripture, because there's fear, there's lack of love, and there's no power to put on the light of God to bring your soul into rest. I want to say that again, because you must understand, lack of love produces fear, but faith works in love. So if there's no love, there's no electricity. Even you put on the switch, faith, you know, if there's no electricity, the light cannot come on. So if there's no electricity, you can quote the scriptures, you can do whatever, because first thing, you must know who you are in Christ. You must come into that peace who Jesus is, and that he died for you, and he really loves you. He really loves you, and his love is, I will help you, I will protect you, I will provide for you. Amen. And then the third one, the natural mind's interpretations of circumstances, and that's temptation. So the devil is using, once our soul is out of peace and we allow fear, we start to interpret and reason our circumstances. We start with more and more fleshly things that we allow in our reasoning. And guess what? The more we fear, and the more we don't have love, and the more the electricity becomes less and less, and you still say, well, I'm a believer, I have faith. Well, where's your faith? Because even you operate in the faith, your faith is only empty words, because you allow the fear to cancel actually the love of God, because you cannot trust God and his love that he will come through for you. Amen. So what does the devil use? Three basic lies. God doesn't love you, and neither does anyone else. You are worthless and of no value. That's a lie. And as long as you are bound to that lie in fear, guess what? You will be punished, because even you try a bit of faith, the electricity, the love of God that actually connects you and your faith in the supernatural, you understand, you were lacking. Second one, or the third one, God won't take care of you and your needs will not be met. So I think, let me stop here. So temptation, you can choose to look the other way. But the main thing is, you must settle your heart. You must settle your soul. You must know that Jesus loves you. And look at the cross. See, the Father sent His only Son, His only begotten Son, to die for you. Do you think He's not able to help you in your crisis? All He says is, just believe me. That's all He says. But you can only believe and activate the power of God if you know that He loves you and you love Him back. Because love is the electricity that connects your faith to the promises of God, and the breakthrough happens, and your soul comes into peace and rest, and you close the flesh door and you start with worship, and you start to just to glorify God out of that. So I'm telling you today, if you struggle with fleshly desires, the problem is your soul is out of peace. You have a problem to understand that Jesus loves you. How do we handle that? Well, we just need to be quiet. Let Jesus just meet you. He wants to take away this burden. He wants you to your soul to come into rest. He wants you to see what you pray for. You want to see what you declare by faith to come into fulfillment. He wants to see that. But the first thing is, that's why the great commandment is all about love. That's why love is the biggest thing about God. Because love is the energy. Love is the electricity which faith activates the supernatural in your life to bring healing, to bring restoration, and bring your soul into peace, and to rebuke all the lies and all the things the devil has bound you. He wants to open that prison today. He wants to break that chains on you today. And I just want to pray for you. Heavenly Father, I pray today restoration, restoration, restoration. I just want to break the shackles. I want to open up this prison where the enemy, through temptation and lies, Father, opened the flesh door. And we sinned, Lord. We allow sin in our lives, and we felt separated from you. And the more we felt separated, the more we lack love. And the more we lack love, the less faith we have to stand up and say, thus says the Lord. But today we look at the cross and we know the price you have paid. We know that the blood of Jesus, once we repent our sins, Lord, the blood of Jesus, you will forgive us our sins. You will bring us closer. You will restore our relationship. You will restore our soul dimension, and the spirit door will start to open, and you will start to bring breakthrough and healing to us in all areas of our lives. And therefore, I pray for the people listening today. Lord, just break this heavy burden in Jesus' name. Just let them break through, Father. But for that, let them experience the love of the Father, so their faith can activate the supernatural, and they can experience the fruit of the Spirit. Father, I bless them. May the messages touch them in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. May God bless you. May you have an amazing day. We will talk again on Friday. I will see. Maybe I want to carry on with this. Let's see what God wants to do. Share this with somebody that struggle, that the soul is out of rest. Share this with somebody that really needs to understand why their faith is not working. Share with somebody that's really struggled and they just cannot be loosened. Share this with people so that God can just touch them and can show His love to them. Amen. May God bless you. May you have an amazing day. Amen.